John Mauldin, thank you very much for joining me here at the Strategic Investment Conference, your namesake conference.
Somebody asked me, are you happy it's over because we're doing this at the end? And I'm going, no, because I can't recall 3 days of more fun that I've had in forever. It is so energizing, the impact of ideas, the mix of people, meeting the attendees. It's about as good as it gets.
Yeah. It has been an intellectual road trip unlike any other. So I want to start by talking about some of what you talked about in your talk yesterday. You mentioned that you feel as if we're set to see currency wars unlike anything that we've seen, you know, that would make the 1930s look like a picnic.
Yes.
Unpack that idea for me.
Well, I think what happens when we enter the next global recession, and I'm not saying this year, next quarter, don't jump off the cliff yet, don't start selling everything. But there are a number of weak links in the international economy, and we're all tied together. And I think the potential for a global recession, which means that all central banks, which are already stretched, they're already at the zero levels, will start employing even more radical, more of the same Keynesian type policies, which to some degree will devalue their currencies. Well, you can only allow so much devaluation if you are China, if you are Germany. And how much stronger, I mean, the odd thing, everybody now expects the dollar to weaken. The odd thing in a situation like this, that even if our central bank began to give us more quantitative easing, the dollar could, on a relative basis, be getting stronger. It would be a very, very odd situation. And then what happens with the emerging market currencies? They're bringing knives to a gunfight. I mean, there's five central banks that are well armed. After that, you know, it's machetes and knives. And it could get pretty funky unless the world's central bankers sit down, much like they did at Bretton Woods, and say, wait a minute, we've got to figure out how to handle what by that time will be $100 trillion of total sovereign debt in the world, you know, 30, 35, 40 in the U.S. I mean, these are unthinkable numbers. And that was kind of the title of my speech, Thinking the Unthinkable. And this is something that is 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, but it's something that I think we start having to war game, plan for, think about in our portfolios and say, okay, how are we going to start planning to have an adjustment for these situations? What's going to get from where we are today, where we will be in the middle of that, and to the other side? Because there will be an other side. At some point, we're going to have to resolve this total debt situation.
What do you think is the most likely way they're going to do it? Because we've heard all kinds of ideas from a jubilee to...
A jubilee of money printing, of monetization, where the central banks of the world, the major central banks, get together and say, okay, guys, as a group, we're going to all monetize together in synchronous, you know, just like synchronous swimming.
This, right.
And to keep currencies from moving and adjusting way too much. Now, what does that do to the one neutral currency? Because I hear a lot of people going, well, gold. It could actually be quite good for gold. And I accumulated enough gold in my portfolio to be comfortable. And a few years ago, I had actually stopped buying gold except for my grandkids and their savings accounts for their college funds. And as I'm thinking through this process, because this is part of my book, The Age of Transformation, as I'm thinking, how will the world change over the next 20 years? It's not just cool new technology. It's economics and geopolitics and generational change and demographics. So as you begin to think through that, I'm going, I think I probably want to increase my allocation to gold and a little bit more central bank insurance.
To what degree is that based on geopolitical risk? Because it seems like those risks are higher than they've been in a long time. And what risks would you slate that in as being just purely economic in terms of what central banks are doing?
I would say it's 90% economic. I think as a geopolitical risk, North America is the safest place in the world. I don't think I've got a lot of worries about an invading army coming into East Texas.
Sure.
So,
Santa Ana's not going to be coming back anytime soon.
This is just not anything that crosses my mind on my worry list. Mm-hmm. So, I am worried about extraordinary monetary policy. And if we get to the other side of this and gold in a deflationary world actually goes down, okay. That means everything else I'm doing has worked and I'm in great shape, and I'll sell my gold or give it to my grandkids, and they'll want to know, Papa John, what are these funny little gold things? Do we play checkers with them? I mean, I don't know, so we'll see.
You used a really unique religious reference to basically describe how you think the Fed is going to move forward, which
yes.
I think is instructive for any investor so they get a clear view of where the path that we're on.
I actually went back to my seminary days and my theological training, and there's something called presuppositionalism. It's from a Dutch Presbyterian, Reformed, very Calvinist thinking. Mm-hmm. But he basically says, if you know a man's presuppositions, your presuppositions that you bring, presuppositions that you bring to the Bible about what truth is and how it understands and whether it's the Word of God or whether it was this one thing or another, your presuppositions will determine your theology. Well, into the central banks of the world, their presuppositions about how the economy works is going to determine their actions and their beliefs and what they will do. And their presupposition is that Keynesianism is the correct way to look at the world. Consumption and stimulating consumption is what they want to do, and they do that with lower rates, easier monetary policy, and they do it by actually increasing debt when, as Lacey Hunt very elegantly laid out for us, and this is conversations and I think the data proves it, too much debt at some point becomes constraining on growth. And so you get into Larry Summers' secular stagnation, which was talked about back in the 30s by one of the original Keynesians. It comes from too much debt. In some way or another, you have to rationalize the debt. Now, you can grow your way out of it, and that's the way we would like to do it, but it doesn't look like we're doing a very good job of growing. And we certainly, with the regulatory regime, the tax regime, with the fiscal regime, with the legal structures and systems and all the constrictions that we have on society today, we're making it difficult to grow. We are the financialization of easy money that the Federal Reserve has created in the global system has actually intervened and interfered with the process of creative destruction. Rather than create companies, buy products, I mean, every other economist up there was showing a chart that says, look, capital expenditures are going down, productivity is going down. And I want to go, well, yes, it's cheaper to buy your competition than to compete with them.
Right.
And that's what the Federal Reserve is rewarding people to do. They're not rewarding them to compete and produce. And in my humble view, my presupposition in economics is that what we don't need is more consumption. What we need is more income and production. What we need is more entrepreneurship and business. And I will agree with Keynes, we have to move the animal spirits, but you do that by creating opportunity.
So based on all of this lay of the land that you've just given us, what practical steps should an investor take right now?
Well, I think you have to recognize that the next 10 years which was the title of our conference, The Decade of Disruption, are going to be unlike any period in the past. And I'm certainly, when I'm saying we're going to have another global recession at some point, because that's what you always do, there's always another recession, it's not going to look like 2008, 2009. You can't go back and say, well, I'll just do what I did then. No, doesn't work. I think what we have to do is to take Markowitz's idea of diversifying among asset classes and take it to the next level, kind of square that, by diversifying among trading strategies which trade those asset classes. And good managers, good people that say, you know, I see value here, and I'm going to take this asset class and I'm going to overweight it or underweight it. I see less value here. I see volatility here. I'm going to manage my risk this way. So we're still diversified because there's no free lunch. We're only going to get what the market and global growth gives us. We're only going to get what we can find out in the world. But let's think about how we want to go about doing that. And by the way, there's 3 billion people coming in to the middle class from around the world. They're going to want more protein. They're going to want refrigerators. They're going to want all of this new technology. So there's opportunity. I'm actually quite bullish, quite optimistic, but I do want to stay out from the onrush of governments and central banks, which I think are kind of threatening that opportunity and prosperity.
Well, John Mauldin, this has been the best economics conference in the world, bar none, and we really look forward to the one next year.
You know, I gotta say, every year I walk out and I'll go, it can never get better than this. And sometime in August or September, I will look up and go, wow. This next year, we're going to make it better. And I start thinking about it. And so next year's number 14, and it'll be back here in Texas. And I hope if you're listening to this, you figure out how to get to Texas sometime in next May.
Well, you have certainly set the bar extremely high to beat this one.
It's a real high bar.
Which means it's going to be amazing next year. Thank you very much for your
time. Thank you.